Good evening and welcome. My name is John Rankin. I'm the chair of the Bishop's Science Department. Thank you for attending tonight's Schaefer Family Foundation Endowed Science Lecture. As always, we are thankful to the Schaefer Family Foundation for funding the endowment that supports this program, and we're glad to have Jim Schaefer here this evening. Mr. Schaefer. Tonight we welcome to campus Dr. Kelly Parsons. We are thrilled to have him back on campus, as Dr. Parsons is an alumnus from the class of 1988. He is also a current member of the Bishop's Board of Trustees and a Bishop's parent. His daughter Leah is in the 10th grade and doing well in my chemistry class, and his son Nathaniel is in the 8th grade. Dr. Parsons is a board certified urologic surgeon and professor of surgery at the UC San Diego Moores Cancer Center. He holds an undergraduate degree from Stanford, an MD from the University of Pennsylvania, and a Master of Health Science from Johns Hopkins. He completed his urology residency and oncology fellowship training at the Johns Hopkins Hospital. Dr. Parsons specializes in the diagnosis and treatment of prostate cancer and is an expert in robotic surgery, laser surgery, and cryosurgery. An author on over 140 medical papers, including studies in the New England Journal of Medicine and the Journal of the American Medical Association, his research focuses on vaccines and other non-invasive treatments for early-stage prostate cancer, magnetic resonance imaging, and patient safety. In addition to his medical practice, Dr. Parsons is the author of the award-winning novel, Doing Harm, which author Stephen King called the best medical thriller I've read in 25 years. We are all looking forward to his next novel, Under the Knife, which will be released on February 7th. Tonight, Dr. Parsons will share the ways in which collaborative, transdisciplinary science invigorates and accelerates medical discovery. Let's all welcome Dr. Parsons.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rankin. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
I like to move a little bit when I talk. I'm not going to move too much, I promise, Melissa, so that I'm not darting away from the camera or anything. I'm absolutely thrilled to be here tonight. Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you for that very, very kind introduction. Mr. Schaefer, thank you so much for the Endowed lecture series. I'm an honored, absolutely thrilled to be a part of it. When I was a student here, I never in a billion years would have imagined that I would be up here speaking about what I'm speaking about tonight. Mr. and Mrs. Teitelman, thank you very much for coming. I can't tell you how honored and thrilled I am to be in this building that did not exist when I was here. And that whole thing with the school car in 1986, your son and I, totally not our fault. Honest, I promise. It's just wonderful to be here with so many familiar faces in the audience. And I see a lot of students in the audience too, which is excellent because I understand like the AP Bio folks are here. Great. I took AP Bio here many years ago. I'm not going to tell you what I got on the AP, but suffice to say, it didn't hold me back from moving on. So thank you all the students who are here. And in fact, what I like to do is I always like to get an idea of who I have in the audience when I'm chatting with folks, when I'm giving a talk. Raise your hand if you are a current student at Bishop's. Outstanding. Okay, good. Raise your hand if you are a scientist or in a science-related field, industry or medicine. Great. Okay. And then raise your hand if you have absolutely nothing to do at all with science. Okay, good. All right, so there's a little something for everybody, I think, in tonight's talk. And what I tried to do is I wanted to keep things a little bit broad-based in talking about things tonight. To take kind of a global picture of science and what science, I think, can do when we break out of the usual ways of thinking about science. And I wanted to start with a question. This is a true or false question for the students. And yes, I know it's after hours, but I'm going to make you answer this. True or false, to be the best scientist possible, I must study only one subject really, really well. Okay? You don't have to answer that now, but I want you to keep that in mind as we go through the lecture. And here's a spoiler alert as someone who writes exam questions. The must with the underline and the only with an underline, those are what we call distractors, or rather, they're when we write test questions, those are things that are trying to reduce the ambiguity in the question. Okay, so there's a reason why I have must there that's underlined, and a reason why I have only there that's underlined. So keep that in mind as we go through the topic today. And again, what I want to do is to take a bird's eye view of things. So while we're starting kind of at this level in meeting here tonight, I want to talk about science more at this kind of a level. So I want to take a global kind of a picture. I'm not going to get into the weeds too much. I'm not going to show you genome-wide arrays for prostate cancer or anything like that, because I don't think it's going to be very instructive. Again, I want folks to think about science, what it means, and what it means to think a little bit outside the box in terms of science. And so, in fact, I'm going to start with something that has absolutely nothing to do with science. I'm going to start with a painting. And this is a painting that hangs at the Tate Gallery in London. It's by a portrait artist named Childress, and it was painted in 1891. And I love this painting. And it's called The Doctor. And there's a lot of things that you can learn from this painting. So you have a sick child, and the sick child's lying on a bed. And it's a makeshift bed. And the bed's been made from two kitchen chairs that have been pushed together and some pillows that are there. And this child is in a house. Houses of modest means. You know, there's a floor, spare floor with a carpet that's just kind of thrown there. There's pewter ware. The parents are in the background, and they're of limited means, clearly, and they're in darkness. And there's the mother, and she has her hands clasped, perhaps in anguish, perhaps in prayer, we don't know. And there's the father looking on, dismayed, trying to comfort his wife. And then you've got daylight streaming through the window. So the idea here is that this was perhaps an all-night vigil. And then you've got the doctor. And the doctor's here, and he's in his formal wear, and he's clearly been at the bedside, and he's leaning forward and attending to the child. And you've got the medicines that are here. You've got some scraps of paper on the floor, and perhaps those are prescriptions. We're not really, really sure. But what we do know is that this doctor who is framed in light with the child, with dawn breaking over, this is kind of the classic image of the doctor. The doctor attending at the bedside. And remember, this was back at a time when infant child mortality were extremely high. This is before most vaccinations. And so this was a time when doctors, and I know a lot of physicians are here tonight, and they'll tell you the same thing if you've studied the history of medicine. This was at a time where doctors, as much as being healers, were there to attend deaths. That's what they were there to do, to attend the deaths of patients. And so this is the classic ideal of the physician. Now, this is another physician. Any of the students in the audience, do you know who this is? Anyone?
Salk.
Jonas Salk, very good. What was Jonas Salk known for? Right, the very first polio vaccine. Now, we don't have any cultural memory of this, okay? So we are many generations removed beyond when hundreds of thousands of children were struck down each year with polio and were paralyzed, were in these big, what they called iron lungs, affected every segment of society, including Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Was afflicted with polio and paralyzed to a certain extent for the remainder of his life. This is the other image of the doctor. This is the doctor as a scientist. Now, Jonas Salk had a medical degree. He worked in a lab. He's the one that made this work. And in fact, he's surrounded with some of the instruments that he would use. So obviously, it's a posed picture, but these are the flasks. These are the culture media that they used to grow the poliovirus, the attenuated poliovirus. And then, of course, here's the microscope. And so these were the real tools of his age. And this is the other idea of the scientist. This is the doctor. This is the scientist as doctor. And so this is what we call in medicine the concepts, this kind of dual concept of the physician-scientist. These kind of alter egos. On the one hand, the Jonas Salk, who's in the laboratory coming up with new ways to treat diseases, and on the other hand, the doctor who's attending at the bedside of the child. Those are the two general roles. And before I talk about how to bridge those roles, I thought it might be instructive, especially to the students who might not know what kind of training you go through in medicine, to give you an idea of how I ended up standing here today. Okay, so after I graduated from Bishop's in 1988, I went to college for 4 years. Then I went to med school for 4 years. Then I went to residency for 6 years. So residency means that you've gotten your MD degree and you're going off and you're learning how to be a real doctor. And let me tell you something, it's nothing like Grey's Anatomy, as the doctors in the office will tell you. Not quite as fun as Grey's Anatomy. Looks to be fun. And residency is anywhere from 3 years to, I know folks who did 12 years of residency for pediatric cardiac surgery. And I did 6 years. And then I decided to do an additional 2 years where I got a master's degree and also learned a little bit more about operating on cancer. That was then, for those of you keeping count, 16 years before I actually got a real job. So during this period of time, I had all the different kinds of things that embody those two roles that we talked about with the scientist and the doctor at the bedside. Because this is when I was operating, this was when I was seeing patients in clinic, I spent time in a laboratory, I spent time crunching data and learning how to program computers. I did all those different things, maybe just trying to figure out what I was eventually going to do with my life. But those were all the different roles that I was trying on in terms of being a scientist. And so then if we go back to this same array, so we go back to the same idea of the scientist in the laboratory and then the doctor at the bedside, there is a pathway. And the pathway is that you come up with inventions in the laboratory, such as the polio vaccine, that you then carry to the clinic. So that you have the laboratory and you have the bedside. And another way of putting it, another way that we talk about it, is bench to bedside. And perhaps a lot of the folks in the audience who are part of the biomedical industry who are physicians understand this. This idea that every single medical treatment that we have ever had, whether it's a surgery, an implant, a medication, which is frequently the most common way that we approach this, every single way that we approach this, it starts in the laboratory and then it eventually ends up at the bedside. And so we call that bench to bedside. That's the model. And this is the actual process that occurs with bench to bedside. So people are probably familiar. Have you heard of like phase two studies or phase three studies or phase one studies for biomedical research? We are a big biomedical town. And so these are the different phases. Now keep in mind that this is the laboratory phase starts about here. This is where the phase comes in where patients are actually getting the kinds of drugs and treatments and the various sorts of things that start in the laboratory and end up here. This is the pathway. So for example, the Food and Drug Administration, the FDA, requires anything that's going to be approved as a medication in the United States has to follow this pathway. That being said, biomedical research can come in at all different phases of this pathway. It can come from here, it can come into here, it can come in this way. And it's always informed. It's always having extra things thrown in from the laboratory, so there's always new things that are being discovered by scientists that have nothing to do with medicine that can inform this pathway. And there's also stuff we call epidemiology and more commonly known now as big data. So all these kinds of population studies, for example, of tens of thousands, if not millions of people, and all of those things can come into play here in terms of informing this entire process of something like a drug starting here and eventually ending up here. And it actually can be simplified. You know, it sounds really complicated when you start talking about phase three randomized clinical trials, but it actually comes down to just a series of questions that you are asking as you take a drug from here. And we're going to talk about drugs. I think that's the easiest way to do it. We talk about a drug starting here and eventually ending up here. The first thing you do is in phase one, you say, okay, I've got this drug. I just invented it in the laboratory. The first thing you ask is it safe? So this is when you put out an ad to people to come in and basically voluntarily get injected with this drug. Okay. So I remember in medical school they had a testing area where I remember they walked us by one time, and it was a bunch of men, mostly young men, who had agreed to be paid to be part of these phase one studies, and they were just sitting around playing Nintendo. Meanwhile, they're being injected with drugs and they're having their blood drawn. And so it's mostly just to see, is it safe, and then also to do what are called pharmacokinetic studies, which is to see if, you know, what kind of drugs, you know, how much do you give a drug? Like, for example, if you invent a drug, the first thing, one of the first things you have to ask is, well, how much drug do I give somebody? You know, how much of this drug? How many milligrams? And so these are the kinds of questions that you ask. The next question that you ask is, does it work? So that's a phase two study where, let's talk about cancer drugs. So in a phase two cancer drug study, you're going to take patients with cancer, let's say prostate cancer, which is what I treat, and you take that drug, and you've determined that it's safe, and you've figured out how much you have to give someone. Then you take it to here to phase two, and you give it to prostate cancer patients. And your first question is, does it work? Okay? And if you get a good answer from that, then your phase three is, okay, it works, but does it really work? And that's where the phase three comes in. Because the phase three, that's the trial, that's the kind of study that people understand or have heard about. That's the trial where people, like prostate cancer patients, come in, you flip a coin, and you say, Mr. Smith, you get a drug, Mr. Jones, you get a placebo, you get a sugar pill. And then we see if it really works. And I can tell you, a lot of stuff that looks good here doesn't look so good here. Then you finally get to phase four, which is what now? So phase three is, okay, the prostate cancer drug works. It cures prostate cancer. Now what do? How do we bring it out into the world? And these kinds of studies are important because, for example, when you test some medications, they look great in the short term. They cure people in the short term. They have limited side effects in the short term. But then when you start giving it to many thousands, if not millions, more patients out in the community for long periods of time, suddenly you discover side effects that you never knew existed, because more people are getting the drug now. And so, for example, there was a drug when I was a resident. Do you remember Trovan? Trovafloxacin? Trovafloxacin, I'm getting some nods from some of the doctors in the audience. Trovafloxacin was a miracle drug. It was this antibiotic that was so incredibly, incredibly powerful. And this was back when drug companies would ply us with gifts and presents. And so, like the residents, we would get free lunches all the time. Please prescribe our drug and prescription pads and, you know, Trovan gear. And I remember it because we had a Trovan magnetic thing for the refrigerator. And it was out for a little while. And then they said, oh, whoops. It kind of causes liver failure. So they only saw that after it had been out for a period of time and they had seen it happen in enough patients to realize that. So they had to pull it from the market. And again, all of these studies are informed by this, by laboratory and epidemiology at every step of the way informing all of that process. So going back to that, phase one all the way to phase four, what a lot of folks have noticed in recent years as science has become more complicated is that this whole process has become more complicated, and now there's a chasm, and it's becoming increasingly hard to bridge this chasm. How do you get from the bench, from the laboratory, into something that can actually treat patients? And so people have been talking about the fact that this classic model of a Jonas Salk or of individuals in the past who were able to invent things in a laboratory and carry it through and literally bring it all the way so that they were able to treat patients. Well, those days are kind of fading fast just because science has gotten so enormously complicated and, frankly, very, very expensive. So the question is, well, how do you bridge this chasm? How do you make it more effective and faster and cheaper and more efficient and more interesting, more creative for you to go from here to here? And I think after having done this now for a while, one of the answers that I have stumbled into, because I can't say that this was a light bulb moment or this was something that I was able to know 10 or 12 or 15 years ago, is that it's all about intellectual diversity. And it's all about getting different teams of people together who have different ways of thinking that you have never even pondered or considered before. Because one of the problems that we've had in science is that we become so siloed. We become experts in one single thing. You become an expert in a certain gene. You become an expert in a certain protein. And when you do that, you learn a heck of a lot about a certain gene or a certain protein, but then you become so focused on that, then you don't start thinking about everything else that could potentially inform your research and potentially make your research all that much better. So along those lines, I want to talk about robots. And I want to talk about two projects, actually, where I think intellectual diversity has served us very, very well over the years at UC San Diego. And again, some of the stuff I'm going to show you, it's going to seem like I thought this through meticulously the entire way. But I got to tell you, science, a lot of science is kind of stumbling your way from one question to another and getting really, really lucky. As Louis Pasteur said, chance favors the informed mind. So I want to talk about robots. And I want to talk about a particular robot in general, and I know there's at least one other surgeon here who operates with this robot. How many folks are familiar with the surgical robot, the Da Vinci system? Very good. So this is the Da Vinci system. Strictly speaking, it's not a robot. It's what the engineers tell me technically is called a master-slave system. And what that means is that I don't flip a switch and the robot does the operation. What happens is, this is the robot with all these different arms. This robot is over a patient. I sit at this console, and I move my hands. So I move my hands here in the console. I sit at the console, I look into this 3D little visor. I move my hands like this in these little stirrups, and the robot arms, which are inserted into the patient, move the same way as my arms. And it's a very interesting way of operating, because previously when we operated, and with a lot of other operations I do, you're right there, obviously, and operating is about putting, frankly, your hands inside people. And so this is completely a different way of thinking. You are completely disconnected from the patient. For the first time, really, this is a form of laparoscopy, and this kind of surgery completely changed the way surgery was done forever. I don't have any videos of the robot tonight just because I thought they would be a little bit inappropriate, and plus a little bit unintelligible to folks who aren't surgeons, really. So I didn't want to show the videos, that's why I'm only showing pictures. But you can see how small these instruments are. That's how small they are. And it allows us to work in spaces and to manipulate things that we just can't do with our hands. And so the robot has completely upended the paradigm for operating. And it's an elegant, elegant machine, extremely well engineered. And to give you an idea of why it makes a difference in what I do. So what I do for a living is I do prostate cancer. And in terms of treating a lot of forms of prostate cancer, the definitive treatment for treating prostate cancer is taking out the prostate. And to take out the prostate, we used to make this kind of an incision here, from just below the belly button all the way down to right about here. Okay, so an incision about that long. Okay, and the thing about surgery is when you're getting better from surgery, you're not getting better from the disease most of the time. You're getting better from what we as surgeons did to you to cure the disease. Because if you think about it, you make an incision, you pull muscles apart, you get down to where you need to go with the disease. And so all of these things basically cause damage to the human body. So if you can minimize that, if you can turn this big incision into little incisions that are this big, where you're not putting your hands in, where you're putting instruments in that are this thick, and you're minimizing that amount of damage to the human body that you as a surgeon are doing, that's why people get better faster. And I'm sure there are folks in the audience that have had things like, say, laparoscopic gallbladder surgery, where you're out the same day. Well, for gallbladder surgery, we used to make an incision this big, and people were in the hospital for upwards of a week sometimes after we took their gallbladders out. Now you go home the same day, mostly because you can make these tiny little incisions, and that's what the robot's done. And the robot has been just huge. It was introduced in 2001, and it was introduced by something called FDA clearance. And this is where my research came in. This is where we started to get interested. So it's something called the 510K process. And what it is the FDA says, if you have a new device, okay, and it's basically the same as devices that have come before it, okay, then you can take a shortcut to getting it approved. So what they say is, if it's substantially equivalent to another device that's come out before, then you can take a shortcut and you don't have to go through those four phases that I was talking about before. In fact, you get to stop here. You get to stop right here, and the FDA has approved your device, and you can take your device out into the world, and surgeons like me can use it. That sounds fine, right? It means it gets to patients faster. It means that people are cured faster and they don't have to deal with all of those big incisions and everything else that we were talking about. And so in terms of a team of people working on this, what you had at this point was that you had engineers who had made this very, very elegant device. They were working with surgeons, particularly a group in what I do. There was a group that was working in Detroit very closely with them, outstanding surgeons who worked this out. And interestingly enough, when they first developed the robot, the company, Intuitive, they were thinking that cardiac surgeons, heart surgeons would want to use it. And the reason why they thought the heart surgeons would want to use it is you have this bone here. Okay, it's called the sternum. And in order to do heart surgery, you have to go through the sternum, which means you have to cut through this big bone to get there. And so when the robot people were developing the device, they thought that the heart surgeons would be overjoyed because they could take these little incisions and take these arms and not go through the big bone anymore. They could go around the bone, basically. The heart surgeons weren't so interested at first. They are now. They're doing it a lot now. We have an outstanding heart surgeon at UC San Diego who does this all the time. They said, we're good. We're good at what we do. Our patients do well. Why should we take risks? Why should we do something differently? They developed it with this group in my field. They kind of found out that this was an excellent kind of device to use for prostate cancer surgery, and it took off to the point where when President Obama visited the Cleveland Clinic, was ecstatic to be able to show off their Da Vinci robot. And let me tell you, the Intuitive folks were so excited about this picture. When this came out. This is the problem, though. And this is the problem that's come out with the 510K process, this shortcut process. The Institute of Medicine is this august body of scientists that you are named to for being a very prominent scientist in your field. And it is supposed to weigh in on very important topics, congressionally mandated topics of great importance to the public health. So for example, there was a report that had come out a number of years ago called To Err Is Human, which pointed out the fact that hundreds of thousands of patients were dying every year in United States hospitals as a result of medical errors. Okay. And that was a very important report that has changed entirely the way that we approach medicine and patient safety. So the Institute of Medicine was asked to look at the 510K process because there have been a lot of complaints about the 510K process. And what they came to the conclusion was, in a very scientific, objective way, was that it was flawed. And they felt it was flawed because it did not reliably assess pre-market safety and efficacy of moderate risk devices. So that's a fancy way of saying that for devices like the robot, the Institute of Medicine did not feel that the safety or even the therapeutic benefit of it, whether or not it was curing people or doing what it was supposed to do, it wasn't really worked out, that the 510K process had to be completely, completely redone. And we thought this was interesting because this was something that had been brewing in my community for a number of years. And the robot, everybody was using the robot, but we weren't really sure what to make of it. We weren't really sure how to introduce it. For example, things like credentialing came up. How do you get credentialed to use this new surgical device that nobody has ever used before? How do you train a team of people to use this new device that has never been used before, even as it's being marketed by the company because it's been cleared by the FDA and hospitals are buying it up left and right? So this is something that had been debated in my field for a number of years and something that we had gotten interested in. So we decided to expand the team. So we had started Intuitive and the original studies had started with engineers and with surgeons. So we switched, we pivoted. So we, of course, had the surgeons, so it was primarily me. But we also either collaborated directly with or we talked to a sociologist, a population scientist who specialized in patient safety and outcomes. He has a PhD, a biostatistician, and a pilot. And you're like, pilot, why would you ever bother to talk to a pilot about something like this? Well, it turns out that a lot of what we are now doing in medicine, the aviation industry figured out years ago about safety. So there is a surgeon at Mass General, a wonderful, wonderful nonfiction writer, if you've ever read some of his books, Being Mortal, for example, Dr. Atul Gawande. And he wrote a book called The Checklist Manifesto, and this was based on his own research. And what he did was he had developed, along with another team, a checklist. So that we all now use this, where checklists are something that are very routine in the aviation industry. So every time you get on a commercial airliner, they go down a checklist. And they go down every kind of safety parameter related to the aircraft. That was something that we never did with surgery. We just started operating. And introducing this into the culture of surgery, I got to tell you, was very hard, because there have been surgeons who've been doing their thing for 20 or 30 years, and they were not so overjoyed about the idea of somebody coming in and telling them, like, no, you can't start till you get down this list of rules, of things, of safety parameters. But the aviation industry had the same struggle, because there have been pilots who had been around for ages who were very affronted by the fact that they would be told to how to run their cockpit. Well, that was the way that they reacted. And of course, there were some surgeons that said, well, how dare you tell me how to run my operating room? But in any event, because of that, because we had started to mimic a lot of what the aviation industry was doing right about patient safety, I talked to a pilot friend of mine. And this is at a time when I was kind of germinating all these different ideas and trying to figure this out, because again, there were no models for how all of this worked. Everybody in my field that was looking at the robot was simply looking at basically whether it cured cancer. You know, that was basically what we were looking at. We weren't looking at safety in a very methodical kind of way. And so I got permission from my friend to go up to Long Beach when he was training on a new aircraft. And this is what really struck me, and this is why I showed this slide and why I got interested in being able to go up with him and do this. My friend is a corporate pilot. He was previously a Navy pilot for many, many years. Then he was a commercial airline pilot for many, many years. So this is an extremely experienced pilot who has logged tens of thousands of hours in the cockpit. Every single time a new plane comes out, he is not allowed to fly that plane until he has been completely, completely trained in the operation of that aircraft by an FAA regulated mechanism. That made me really interested, because surgery, even today, does not have anything equivalent to that. So if a new robot comes out, if a new device comes to market, we have nothing comparable to what the FAA does with pilots. And so I went up and I was very interested in this. This is the outside of the simulator. This is the inside. It looks exactly like a cockpit. It's not on right now, but when you flip a switch, what happens with these screens is it can become any airport in the world. Any airport in the world. Photorealistic. And they can simulate any conditions that they need to in order to train the pilots. And the simulator itself is a little bit like, you know, Star Tours or something at Disneyland. And so those are all hydraulics on the outside. And so the more I pondered this, the more I turned this around in my brain, the more that I talked to people who had nothing to do with my field. Sociologists, population scientists, all these different folks who are on the other side of campus from me at UC San Diego, the more this kind of picture started to emerge of what safety in the robot really, really meant. And some of the things that I started reading that really informed what this was all about was the tipping point. Have any of the students in the audience read the tipping point? A few. You guys should totally read this. I think you would be really, really interested, and it's a quick read. And don't read it for class, don't read it for homework, don't read it for extra credit. Just read it when you have a chance. It's really, really interesting. This one, not so interesting. This is a little bit more of a textbook. This is a textbook on the diffusion, what's called the diffusion of innovations, because there's an entire science behind this. People who've spent their entire careers studying how things percolate after they come out. And in fact, there's something called the diffusion curve. This curve, which is an S curve, applies to anything you can possibly imagine. So for example, the new iPhone. The new iPhone looks like this when you bring it to market. Introducing new types of seeds in 1950s Iowa for certain crops of wheat looks like this. It's basically a way of describing anything that's a new idea, or in the case of the robot, a surgical innovation that has never existed before and is expanding through a population of people who are interested in it. And so in the case of the robot, this would be a population of surgeons, and this would be how quickly surgeons start using the robot. Nobody had ever done this before because nobody had ever bothered to walk across campus and talk to people that did this for a living. This was already all worked out. I mean, marketers use this at companies. Sales folks use this kind of modeling. So what we did was we simply applied it to the robot. I say simply, this is after 2 or 3 years worth of a hardcore work with a Harvard-trained biostatistician she's absolutely amazing. And what we started to see was this emerging pattern. We were able to access a large group of patients who were having operations in the United States, tens of thousands of patients through publicly accessible data. Nobody had ever done this before. And what you see here is the number of the surgical procedures is on the y-axis, so how many surgeries were being done is here. And on the x-axis is year, and this is about when the robot started to kind of begin to percolate. And what you see here is the early part of that S-curve. And that's the robot. What you see here, the dark line, that's the old-fashioned way of doing the surgery. So that was starting out here in 2003. Everybody was doing it the old-fashioned way. Nobody was using the robot. And then right about here, nobody saw this coming. It all of a sudden happened. Everybody started using the robot, and consequently, nobody was doing it the old-fashioned way anymore. And the curves crossed about here around 2008, 2009. That's how quickly it happened, because that's what innovations do when they diffuse. They hit what's called this tipping point, as Malcolm Gladwell pointed out, and suddenly they take off exponentially. And then we said, okay, so this is what's going on, and this is another illustration of it. So here, this is just robots. So this is just the number of robot surgeries. The y on the x-axis rather is year, and on the y-axis is the number of robot surgeries that were done. Excuse me, the percentage of robot surgeries that were done. So out of all prostate cancer surgery that was being done, this was the percentage that was being done robotically. And here again is that takeoff point. Mathematically, the tipping point was occurring about here, and this was just taking off. And this was what we saw. And I just selected this one slide. We had a whole bunch of other figures and data that I don't want to plow through tonight. But this is what we saw. The tipping point was here. This is when the robot really started to take off. And what we saw here in 2005, right before the robot took off, was that if you had robotic surgery, so you went in for your prostate cancer surgery, and you had it done with the robot as opposed to having it the old-fashioned way, you were almost 3 times as likely to suffer from a serious and completely preventable bad thing happen to you in the hospital. Completely preventable bad thing. I won't go into details, but some of the bad things included, for example, being admitted to an intensive care unit, when you should never have been admitted to an intensive care unit after this surgery. So what we saw was this pattern start to emerge through various hospitals, was that right before this took off, it was unsafe. It was unsafe to have the robotic surgery compared to the old-fashioned way of doing it. After that, it didn't really matter. It was about the same. And now if you follow this curve out later, there's a lot more data that's come out now that actually suggests it's actually safer now to have the robotic surgery than the old-fashioned surgery. Well, why did this happen? Well, you can only really speculate, really. Much of our speculation focused around the idea that this was a new device. This was something that folks didn't have any credentialing process for. This was something that we hadn't thought out the process of how it should be introduced to society at large, or how you should train an operating room team. Because remember, an operating room team is not just me. An operating room team is my assistant surgeon, who's usually the resident in our training program. It's the scrub nurse who's working with me. It's the anesthesiologist who's working with me. It's somebody called the circulating nurse who's in the room with me. All these people are part of the process. As any of the robotic-using surgeons will tell you, this is an extremely complex device, and the learning curve is challenging in terms of using it for everybody in the room. So it caused a little bit of a splash when it came out, and it generated a lot of debate. And there have been a lot of talk moving forward in terms of more properly, I think, regulating the process in terms of the way new devices come out. Interestingly, that's not happening, to my knowledge, on the government side so much. It's actually happening at the level of the surgical societies. So, for example, the ACS, the American College of Surgeons, which is this very august organization, has been very interested in this whole process and is very interested in regulation, is very interested in credentialing. So what has ended up happening from our work and the work of others is that now this process is becoming a lot more regulated at the level of surgeons, if not the level of the government, at least at the level of surgeons. So let's shift a little bit and talk a little bit now about something that's of great interest to me and to my team currently, and that's magnetic resonance imaging. And that's using, also called MRI, it's basically using a big magnet to look inside the body. So a couple years ago, a radiologist I work with came up to me and he said, we've been doing this stuff with brain imaging. And it hasn't really been done before. Magnetic imaging, resonance imaging of the brain, I think it might work for prostate cancer. What do you think? I said, nah, it's not going to work. I'm not interested. Because at that point, magnetic resonance imaging, MRI for prostate, just was not working. It hadn't helped us at all. It was really nothing that I was excited about. It was nothing really that most people were excited about. But he persisted, and he showed me some data. And he showed me some data with what are called glioblastoma multiforms, or GBMs. And these are very, very aggressive tumors of the brain. And basically what he showed me was this. As a non-radiologist, I could appreciate this right away, as I hope you can. Red and orange is bad. So red and orange is bad. That's all you need to know when you look at these images and the way that they relate to cancer. And he showed me this, and he said, we've really developed this restricted spectrum imaging, RSI, and what we found is that it really correlates well to what it actually looks like under a microscope. These are tumors underneath the microscope, and basically, when you look under a microscope at tumors, you tend to see disorganized heaps, and you see a lot of blue, which is bad. And so he showed me this, and he said, I think this really would apply to prostate cancer. And so we started to think about it a little bit more, and we started to inch forward a little bit with it. And all you need to know, I'm not going to go over prostate anatomy with you tonight, all you need to know is that this big circle is the prostate. And this is one of our earlier images that basically showed orange and red, and this was a cancer. And now I started to get interested. I'm like, this is really, really interesting. RSI, restricted spectrum imaging, the way I understand it, the way that I can explain it at least, without having a degree in physics, is that essentially helps measure the water density of cells. So that cancer cells tend to not have a lot of water in them because they're densely packed, as opposed to normal cells, which have a fair amount of water in them. And that contrast between normal cells and densely packed cells is what the RSI picks up. So we started to get interested in that, and we started to do some papers and started to look at it more. And the radiologist, Dr. Caro, was especially interested. He thought, I think this can be really good in patients with prostate cancer who we can help determine how far the prostate cancer has spread. I think this will be a great use for it. So that's where we started. And we found actually, so what this essentially shows is that this is a prostate on the MRI, this big circle. Again, orange and yellow is bad. And then when we took the prostate out of people, when we cured their cancer with surgery, what we saw was that this orange and red correlated perfectly to what we were seeing when we looked at the prostate under a microscope, because this is the whole prostate underneath a microscope. And not only that, we could tell. We could tell with some amount of certainty, can tell with some amount of certainty, when the cancer is starting to push its way out of the prostate, when it's starting to spread. And it correlated perfectly with what we saw on the laboratory analyses. So then I said, well, can you actually tell me a little bit more about the cancer itself? For example, there are different types of prostate cancer. It's what we call grading. It tells me how aggressive a prostate cancer is. How good are we at being able to tell for the first time? Wait a second. Okay, we'll go to that first and then come back. So how good would you be able to tell me about how aggressive a cancer is just by looking at it on an MRI? And he said, well, I think we could be pretty good. So we did a project where we basically were able to show for the first time that with this twist on the MRI, we can diagnose the aggressiveness of a tumor, of a prostate cancer tumor. So basically, this whole title is a fancy way of saying we can look at an MRI and tell you how bad your tumor is. And we've never been able to do that before. So now I'm starting to get really, really interested in this. And I said, well, okay, this is good to use in prostate cancer patients, but what about patients who've never been diagnosed with prostate cancer before, but we suspect that they have prostate cancer? Because I can tell you, the way that we diagnose prostate cancer has not changed in 30 years. And I'm not gonna tell you how we do it. I'm gonna tell you it's unpleasant, it's uncomfortable, and I would never wish it upon my worst enemy. And I did four of them today in clinic. And we've been struggling with that because that's the way that we've been diagnosing it, and that's the way, it's the surest way to be able to diagnose it. But I started thinking and talking with my collaborators, again, in a way that I never would have unless the radiologist came to me and said, hey, what do you think about this? We started talking, and now this is our vision. Our vision is we want to completely upend the way that we diagnose prostate cancer. So instead of using needles inserted into people, which is typically how prostate cancer is diagnosed, or any kind of cancer, what we want to do is to be able to characterize a cancer completely on an MRI, even down to the DNA level, which is what we're starting to work with, and combine that with a blood test. That's our vision. Now, I don't know when that vision will occur. I don't think it's going to be in 5 years. We might be looking 10 or 15 or even 20 years down the line. But I think that's exactly how we have to think. And so now, what happens? So previously, it was kind of just me, the surgeon, and me, the radiologist. Now, for the latest project that we have, we've got a whole bunch of people who do different things. We've got a surgeon, we've got an immunologist, a radiologist, a pathologist, and a biostatistician. And just for fun, lately, we've thrown in a geneticist, because again, we want to be able to see if we can even get down to the genetic level on the MRI, and also a computer scientist. Because, and I know there's a radiologist in the audience, Dr. Nelson, I'm so sorry, but we're interested in machine learning for diagnosis of images on radiology. So that's a fancy way of saying that we want to replace the radiologists who usually do diagnosis of prostate cancer with a machine. The reason why we want to do that is actually we see it coming anyway. GE has already got a project working on breast cancer with machine learning. We see it coming down the pike, and we want to get ahead of it. And we want to be able to bend it to our will and to be able to determine if it can make us better. For example, we diagnose people with prostate cancers who had completely clean MRIs. We call it a false negative. Why is that? I don't know. We need to figure out why, and that's exactly the kind of thing that machine learning could potentially allow us to achieve. So whenever you do collaborative work, it really, really is how a bill becomes a law. So the older folks in the audience will recognize this. Maybe some of the younger folks, my kids didn't really take interest in this. This is the kind of thing that like parents like eagerly buy the DVD and like try to show your children, and the kids are like, eh, whatever. But this is the kind of stuff that we grew up with. And so this is how this was the Schoolhouse Rock series, and this was the I'm Just a Bill and How a Bill Becomes a Law. And that's really what scientific collaboration is all about. It's a bunch of people who are all coming from a different way of thinking, who frequently end up getting into heated arguments. It's a little bit like democracy. Yes, it's messy. And it can be unstable sometimes and polarizing, but ultimately it's the right way forward, because I think that the science ends up becoming better. And the science ends up becoming better because what happens when somebody challenges your argument? You have to up your game, and you have to hone your own argument, and you have to think about why you're saying what you just said. You know, somebody might say, Dr. Parsons, I completely disagree with your outlook on prostate cancer. And I could get angry at that, but that's not the right response. The right response should be, okay, I believe this. Why do I believe this? I better back up my argument with some real data and some real facts. And it ends up making me that much better. And so that's why I think collaborative science in many different ways makes the science better, not just because you're breaking out of your silos and you're interacting with people who think completely differently, but because in doing that, they are raising your individual game and your individual way of thinking. Now, how much is too much? Of course, you can have almost too many collaborators on a study. This is a study that's currently in press at a major journal. I'm not allowed to tell you which one because there's something called embargoing. So I'm not allowed to tell you exactly where this is going to come out. But this is a pretty impressive list of people who are on it. I'm tucked up in there somewhere. And I feel really badly for Dr. Siebert, who is one of our outstanding postdoctoral fellows, because not only has he had to corral all of these cats, but there are all kinds of different rules that he has to follow when he submits to a journal about getting everybody's permission. And you can imagine with all these different people running around in different directions at once, trying to get them to send in forms on email can be very, very challenging. And you'll see frequently now these papers that come out in big journals like Nature or Science that have author lists that are like half a page long because so many people have been involved because the projects are so complicated. How many is too many? I don't know the answer to that. We haven't gotten to that point yet in our particular brand of research. I think we've been very lucky in that sense, and we've had a very collegial, collaborative kind of group. Now, my children would kill me because this is like an old person trying to sound cool, but you know, haters gotta hate, right? So what happens when you submit a research paper? There's something called the peer review process. Peer review means that I have my paper, this is my baby, this is what I have worked on for the last 3 years of my life, and I send it to a journal, and I think this is the greatest piece of science ever written. And then a bunch of other scientists who do what I do anonymously read my paper and comment on it and say yay or nay. So I've collected some of my favorite comments over the years that I've collected from various peer reviewers. These are actual comments that I received. Pseudoscience, ludicrous, subversive, falls well short of good science. This last one actually was not a peer review. This actually was a very unhappy group after our paper came out that disputed our findings and demanded that we retract the paper. For the students in the group, let me put it this way. If somebody demands that you've just retracted a paper, that means one of two things. Either you're admitting that you're a complete idiot and you didn't do your due diligence and that you didn't do good science, or you're a liar. That's what they were asking us to do. Needless to say, we did not. We believed in it, and it worked out just fine. But I put this up here mostly for the students. This applies to anything that you're going to do when you go out into the world. Okay, when you go out into the world, you're going to face critics. You're going to tell people. People are going to tell you you don't know what you're talking about. They're going to be unkind. They're going to be very, very unkind, especially when they're making anonymous comments. But they'll also do it to your face. And I have seen screaming matches between eminent scientists at national meetings. Screaming matches, sarcasm, all sorts of different things. You have to be prepared for that, and you cannot get down to that level. You cannot react with emotion. And you have to be even-handed about it and not take it personally. Because I can tell you, when I get a comment like this is pseudoscience from a peer reviewer. I have to put it away for a couple days, because I'd be lying to you if I told you that I wasn't furious the first time I saw that. I put it away for about a week, and then I'll come back to it. And the first thing I'll ask myself is, why did this reviewer think this was pseudoscience? What am I not communicating effectively? What are the holes in my data? What do I have to go back to make this and do to make this argument better? Okay, so coming back to our question. To be the best scientist possible, I must study only one subject really, really well. Okay, how many students, only the students can answer, how many in the audience, students in the audience say that that's true? How many of the students in the audience say that that's false? Thank you very much. So you were paying attention, if only to the fact that I was giving you hints about the must and only. So that's false. And then one more, true or false, to be the best scientist possible, I should only study science. This is a curveball. I wasn't telling you you were going to get ready for this, but here's that only again, and here's the underline. To be the best scientist possible, I should only study science. True or false? Trues. False. Excellent. Good. Okay, that's false. And let me tell you a little bit about why. This is a tough one. You got Jonas Salk. Do any of the students know who this is? Yes. No. Not the one who invented the polio medicine.
That's not Jonas Salk.
This is a different gentleman. This is a different scientist. Does anyone know who this is? Okay. Francis Collins. This is Francis Collins. Very good. This is the director of the National Institutes of Health. So this is one of the most preeminent scientists in the nation. He is a preeminent geneticist. So you guys are too young to remember, but the Human Genome Project, the project that decoded the human genome for the first time, there were two competing groups, a private venture and a public venture, the NIH, the National Institutes of Health venture. The private venture was led also by a preeminent scientist who happened to be in town, J. Craig Venter, and then Francis Collins, who led the public one, and they announced their data jointly. And Francis Collins is just an absolutely phenomenal, amazing individual. He is revered as one of the great geneticists of recent times. And also, I'm told, an outstanding clinician. He was a practicing oncologist for many years before he went to the laboratory. Well, he's also a New York Times best-selling author who writes openly about his faith, his Christian faith, and the way it informs his science. And he's written a book called The Language of God. And he also plays an amazing guitar. This is him with the Edge from U2. And this is, I mean, it's not like just he kind of plucks. I've actually heard him play. He's really, really good. And he's also one of the most phenomenal commencement speakers I've ever heard in my life. I got to hear him speak at my wife's medical school graduation. And so here's a gentleman who's one of the most preeminent scientists of his time, who also writes books and also plays with The Edge from U2. I mean, that's absolutely amazing. It's absolutely amazing. And I mean, you knew this was coming. I had to give the shameless plug, but this is a segue. This is a segue. I'm not saying by any means that I am Francis Collins. I never will be. I'll never be up to his game, certainly. But the point I make is this, is that when you get really, really interested in science, you think, this is it. I want to do science. I'm just doing science and nothing else. Don't shy away from the other things that might make you a little bit less comfortable. Like if you go to college and you're like, well, why would I ever want to go take poetry or history or you know, English or whatever? Think about it. Take the things that you're interested in college, go through the course catalog, and take stuff that's interesting to you. Keep your other passions, whether you're an athlete, you're in community service, you play an instrument, you do all of those. Do that, because I can tell you from personal experience, you can only think about science so much before your brain is dead. Seriously. You have to switch to something else. And for me, I have found that when I flex different areas of my brain, it keeps me fresh, it keeps me sharper, and allows me both to be a better doctor, but then also a better researcher. And that's why I write books. And that's why I get the question frequently, how do you find time to do it? And I find time to do it because I have to do it, because I can't think about medicine all the time. I have to think about something else. And with that, I'll close. And I do apologize. I wanted to leave a little bit more time for questions, but I'm happy to take questions at this point. Thank you for your attention.